forge your inner armor.
Players will try to achieve this slowing down their brain and everything else by just telling themselves to calm down, right? I mean, talk a little bit about that. You know, obviously it's a good thing to do to go, you know, walk to the other end of the tee box, take a breath, try to calm down, but you can't sort of fix what's going on with your autonomic nervous system by just sort of telling yourself to take it easy and calm down.
The idea of go take a deep breath is ridiculous. I mean, that's not going to do it. And that, I think that brings us to one of our first big kind of concepts in here, which is what I refer to as continuum golf. If you think about your golf swing, it's probably a second and a half. If we added it up on a good round.
If it's 1.5 seconds for a swing, which seems about right, let's say you shoot a 70, 2 under par. So 70 times 1.5, that's 105 seconds. Which is less than 2 minutes. So out of a 4-hour round of golf, you're only actually hitting the ball less than 2 minutes.
And that's the space. I'm not even going to say it's the space in between. It's the space that dominates. That isn't just a one breather. I mean, who knows how many breaths you're going to breathe during that 3 hours and 58 minutes. If we want to be breathing 6 breaths a minute, nobody's thinking about it, and they're putting themselves in very poor autonomic nervous system preparation for that next shot. And we have to be preparing in between every second with what's going on with the nervous system for these continuum golf. You know, the golf coaches are there, the swing coaches, they're going to do their thing, and they're all really good. My job is to help you do all the 3 hours and 58 minutes. Get your head into the game and your body and your brain under complete command and control. A lot of times we try to separate in many things, but golf in particular, the mind over the body, and don't create that connection that actually, when leveraged correctly, can become a very powerful tool. And so as I've studied this in golfers, what we've discovered is that there's something that's called the point of action that we've defined. And in this point of action, we define a place in that breath that we want to create impact on the ball. And so there's also another place right before that, that in the swing would be the time at which we pull the club back. We prepare it for the swing. We'll also talk in a later episode about how we put this all into a full golf routine. But in the point of impact, we're leveraging the up and down of the nervous system. And it's at that moment that we want to line up every system in our body when it's in that relaxed state. And that's when we're going to impact the ball. And that becomes the rails upon which we put the train of golf on. And where I like to start with most people is the autonomic nervous system, and you even alluded to today, is taking information through our visual system. So, you know, we get 11 million pieces of information a second, 10 million of them are visual. Think about how much visual demand is on you when you're playing golf. I mean, you could just put the list of different things that you need to be doing visually. And so much of those are judging distances, depth perception, right? And so you've got a card that's telling you what the yardage is, or you've walked it off and it tells you what the yardage is. But if your binocular system is not strong, and that's the use of both the left and the right eye, you're going to get information unconsciously about that distance that may be in conflict with what your brain is telling you about that distance. The card is telling me this. I walked it off. The putt is 15 feet. But my eyes, because I don't have a very precise binocular system, which has to do with convergence and divergence of both eyes that work like two cameras to give me this beauty of binocularity. If those aren't precise and they're telling me unconsciously, no, that looks like it's 13 feet. But I'm saying to myself, no, it's 15 feet. Then I go to sit over the putt and I have this conflict. I've got the unconscious pushing against the conscious. The unconscious will always win, by the way. And I fall short, right? Or I read it too far left. The most important muscles in golf are your eye muscles. And I would love to ask how many people trying to play the game of golf or playing at an elite level are working on the synchronization of their eye muscles. And it's funny, in the pro football side, I have quarterbacks that before games will come in and do our visual training to almost like stretch their eyes and get them in sync, just like we would stretch our legs or our arms. And I have golfers that do this as well. Because those muscles, they got to go out and they got to be acting that whole 4 hours, and they better be dead on correct and line up the conscious with the unconscious, or I'm going to make mistakes that are more reflective of poor perception or poor data inputs. Your pupils in the eyes actually change based on stress and relaxation. So they can become dilated or they can become constricted. And when they're dilated, what happens is we become very tunnel vision. So it's very narrow because it's a stressful state. And that narrowness causes us to really compromise our depth perception. So when I've activated the adrenal system, not only am I causing other issues with, you know, breathing and heart rate and my muscle activity, but I've also changed my pupil to make it more dilated and create more tunnel vision and lose my depth perception. But you probably never really thought about that. Like when I am stressed, now my visual data is further compromised because my eye is taking in information differently because it thinks it needs to focus on what's right in front of me, like the snake, right? Like when I'm in the woods and the snake comes out and I go into sympathetic, my pupils will dilate so that I can become very focused on that snake. And I could care less about what color the leaves are or the little squirrel in the tree to my right because I am tunnel vision. We'll use that sometimes when we talk about people who are really obsessive, is their tunnel vision, but that literally happens as a protective mechanism. And how do we fight against that as a golfer and as a coach of a golfer? How do I teach them to control that so that that doesn't become my enemy in this whole process? There's already enough things to conquer on a golf course, right?